CIUT 89.5, Toronto.
Hey, good evening and welcome to HOWL. This is your host for the hour, Nancy Jane Bullis. We're in the chair tonight, and I think maybe spring has sprung. And we have a very packed show tonight, so I hope you can stick around for the hour. We'll be speaking with Alan Breezemaster, who is a poet and a publisher, and he'll be reading some of his poems and talk about some events that are coming up. And we'll also be speaking with Degan Davis about his debut poetry book published by Brick Books called What Kind of Man Are You? And then we will be speaking with Joe Denham in BC, who will be talking about his book, poetry book called Landfall, Nightwood Editions. I just want to say this is an all-inclusive language show, and some of the language may be strong or offensive to some listeners, and just to let you know that before we go ahead. And this is CIUT 89.5 FM, and we have in the studio Alan Breezemaster, who is a poet, freelance editor, and publisher who has been active on the Toronto area literary scene for many years, first as a workshop leader and later as a reading series organizer and volunteer. He is the author of 7 full-length books of poetry, the most recent of which are Against the Flight of Spring, which was published by Quattro Books in 2013, and River Neither, Aeolus House 2015, and I believe he may be reading from that book tonight, and 7 shorter books. Alan has read his poetry, given talks, and hosted book launches, Adventures from Victoria to St. John's, Newfoundland. In June 2017, he was awarded life membership in the League of Canadian Poets. He lives in Thornhill, Ontario, with his wife Holly, who is a visual artist, a very talented visual artist, whose drawings collages and paintings have been reproduced in a number of his books and on some of their covers. Welcome, Alan.
It's good to be back here again, Nancy. Yeah. Thank you for inviting me back to a slightly longer stint than my previous appearance, which I very much enjoyed.
Yeah, I just felt we just, radio being radio, it just seemed that the time ran out and I felt that there was more to say, so
always lots more.
I thought it'd be nice to have you back and we could continue where we left off. And I guess to start with, to let people know, you're a publisher of Aeolus House, which is a mini press, you call that?
Micro press.
A micro press. So what's a micro press?
Well, as I would define it, it's a press that produces limited edition books.
Oh.
And chapbooks. The full-length books, a typical run is around 200 copies. And the other small presses, due to grant restrictions and so on, or guidelines rather, they will do, you know, at least 400, maybe 500 or more books, and they have some kind of a marketing wherewithal to try and get the books known and in stores across Canada. My authors are. Tend to be more localized and have a smaller audience, and I don't have the resources to do extensive marketing and promotion, and the authors know that. With the chapbooks, I do a run typically of 100 or 150 copies, and if the run is about to sell out, I will certainly print another 50 or 100 if the demand warrants.
Yeah. And they're beautiful books that you do, that I've seen.
Yeah, I like to think of them as artisan type books.
Yeah.
And having a press where it's a one-man show largely, although I hire a professional designer. I don't do the design work myself. And of course, I hire a printer to print the books, often Coach House Printing, which does a high-quality work.
Yeah,
and the designers do designer books. They are tailored to the style and content of the book, and to a large extent to the author's wishes, although the author doesn't dictate it. We both have to agree that this is a really... the cover, the font for the type inside, and all the elements are to both of our likings and really suits the character of the book. Mm-hmm. So each book is really unique.
Unique.
Yeah.
So there are two events. Is it tomorrow night?
Yeah, I wanted to give a plug to two events which are on the at exactly the, almost exactly the same time, and I'm going to one of them myself because one of my authors from Aeolus House, Stanley Pfefferman, is having the official launch of a book that's been out for a little while now, called The Heart of All Music. They're poems, all poems about music. Uh-huh. And Stanley had a book last year from Quattro Books, which I edited, and he came back right away. He had another manuscript, and one of the advantages of a micropress is we can turn on a dime. I give the text as much editing as it needs to truly get up to speed, and sometimes within a matter of just several months, if all is falling into place as it should, you get your book. You don't have to wait for 2 years or sometimes more the way
sometimes
that
more.
Other presses, for very understandable
yeah,
reasons.
Yeah, very valid, yes.
Yeah,
it's
have
not,
to,
not
have
a
to
criticism
make you wait.
At all, yeah.
Yeah, so yeah, Stanley's book and a book by Carl Hare, who's out of Kelowna, BC.
Wow.
And there's an interesting story about that. It's an epic length a book about the English poet Edmund Spenser in Spenserian stanzas. Quite a tour de force book.
There's a challenge.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing that book. And Rocco Di Giacomo, who's quite well known around
Toronto,
very
talented writer.
Has a new book of poetry. It just came out very recently with Quattro. So that evening, it'll be at Supermarket at 6:30. Supermarket's on Augusta Avenue, you know, just a little bit west of Spadina, south of
College.
Yeah, well-known venue. Yeah, early start time, 6:30. And yeah, unfortunately, there's a Poetry Month reading I'm interested in, would have liked to go to over at the Main Street Library, organized by James Deal, and it has a number of notable local poets and some coming from other places. That's at 6 o'clock, so I can't be in both places at once.
No.
And I know there are a couple of other, I mean, it's Poetry Month, there are a couple of other events that are also worthwhile, but I'd like to highlight those two because friends are involved in both. So listeners, take your pick if you're free. They're both going to be rather good.
Yeah, it sounds it. Yeah, it's Poetry Month. April is Poetry Month, which is lots of activity and things going on. And so you've brought two of the books that we talked about before: River Neither, and Pod and Berry, which were both published by Aeolus House.
Yeah, Pod and Berry is a chapbook. It's perfect bound, but just 32 pages.
Yeah, it
and
is
I really like the design of this book. It was designed by Carlton Wilson, who's one of the best designers
he
in
does,
town or
yeah.
in the nation.
Yeah.
And I always feel fortunate if he can find the time because he's working for other presses and his own Junction Books.
Yeah, I'm sure he's quite busy.
But he found the time last fall, and this came out in October, so it's still pretty new. And I'd say very happy with it in all respects. And it's good to have a book, a little chapbook, or maybe not so little, in between your major books. And my next major book, as far as I know, won't be out until 2020, which seems an eternity away. It's with one of those presses that, you know, understandably, justifiably make you wait a couple of years.
Just because to get you into queue, really.
Yeah. I won't mention anything specific because I don't want to jinx it yet. There still has to be a little bit of paperwork, but I've been assured that this is definite for 2020. And I hope I'll be back on the show when that book is out. And I'm certainly going to travel across the country with it, because it will be a substantial book.
So it's written?
Yes.
What is it along the same themes that you tend to write a lot about nature, and you like to explore form, is my understanding, and music seem to be.
Yeah, I write about the arts, science as well, and personal things. I think more increasingly, and social concerns, interpersonal. But when I started years ago, I think I was rightly or wrongly known more as a nature poet. I still write about nature because, my goodness, we live on the earth here, and it's the ecosystem, needless to say, very much under threat.
And it needs us to appreciate it.
But I find even when I try to celebrate a wonderful experience I've had in the natural world, my awareness of its threatened condition, will seep into the poem inevitably. I will divulge to the world that this book actually is selected poems. It will be poems from six different full-length books, and actually selected and new. The new poems will have some from the Pot and Berry chapbook and some others which I have written since the chapbook, but got in the manuscript in time to be accepted as a whole package.
So do you write every day?
I try and write a little bit every day. I feel a day is not completely fulfilling unless I maybe, as the was it Oscar Wilde said, take out a comma or put one back in. At least do something.
Do something.
If I even make some revisions, eliminate an adjective that was superfluous, I feel that something's accomplished. But more likely, I try to develop something that's been sketched or start something new, and that doesn't happen every day. But I do try and do something each and every day. I don't have a regular schedule, but there's always time to open up your folder or your file on the computer and look at what you've got there, or drop in a new phrase or a sketch of your next poem.
Yeah. Do you carry a notebook with you?
I do. Yeah. I find the moleskin notebook is very handy if I'm, out in the woods or, maybe on the subway or that. I have another pad where I keep my sort of business to-do and longer notes and drafts of emails and so on, and drafts of poems get in there too. I can actually write on the subway sometimes, or at least edit and revise it, tune out the world.
Yeah.
I don't mind a noisy cafe either. But I get most of my starts if I'm on a walk in the outdoors. It can be in an urban setting, but preferably more a natural setting where there isn't, the channels seem to open up to the cosmos.
And they're probably more immediate to it than if you're around a coffee machine and...
Yeah, but it can come to you under almost any circumstance, I find, and I just try to be ready for it. So it's important to carry a notebook of some sort, because it's like a dream. If you don't put it down right away, it's going to evaporate most likely.
That's a good word. They evaporate. So would you like to read from us? I know you brought you've brought lots of books here. We have Pot and Berry.
Yeah, I think I'd like to focus on Pot and Berry a bit, since it is newer, and I've enjoyed reading from it here and there, and some poems are particularly favorites to read. I read a couple the last time I was here, but I don't think I read the short elegy that is in the poem. It's dedicated to someone you knew who was involved in the Art Bar series for a while. Not really a poet. His gift was more for photography, but I did publish a chapbook for him, James Latrobe, who
yes.
passed away about a year and a half ago.
I'm so
you
sorry.
You didn't know? He was a very close friend.
He was a talented, I like James Latrobe.
Yeah, he had some wonderful photography, and actually I published his memoir of different episodes from his life with my press, and he was working on that up till the end and had just finished it with photographs on the front and back cover, a very beautiful little book. At his memorial, I was able to launch the book.
To have the book well, may he rest in peace. And you've got a poem to read?
Yeah, it's called Our Path. We climb on through the wounds, which are, after all, not fatal, only mortal. And so we will go, whether safe or at risk, to earth, to waters, toward skies of amenable stars, yet never be bound away from true friends in the long bond with them. There is hurt, even so I refuse being sealed. I stride or limp after what moves beyond all, which is also within and gives lift to the load. It undarks at the knowing this path cannot shut, how something far in us goes on, reaches past the lone end.
Thank you, that's beautiful. This is CIUT 89.5 FM, and we're talking with Alan Breezemaster, who is reading from his chapbook called Pod and Berry, published by Aeolus House. So that book is divided into, I guess, well, the outside world with nature and then the within, the internal, sort of what you're talking about, the personal, interpersonal relationships.
Yeah, of course, both worlds are least adjacent and more often interpenetrate, but there's those two kind of two centers for the ellipse of the book.
Would you like to read one more or something from River Neither?
Well, I thought I could.
Or you wanted to read something new?
I'm going to try. I tried this out on Holly earlier today, and I will. Don't mean to blame it on her. This is a new one.
She'd get credit. Hi, Holly.
Get credit for it. That I wrote the morning that I left a wonderful week in Bermuda. I was there in tropical paradise while the rest of you here were
fending
off
with
the ice.
Yeah.
Very fortunate, and it's kind of a reflection on the. The escape into a very pleasant place. I won't dwell on the intro too much, but you know, along the lines of escape, the remark by J.R.R. Tolkien comes to mind that you know the only people who don't like a little escape are the jailers.
Ah.
This is called A Departure from the Island of Away, and the title doubles as the first line. Departure from the island of away brings on a sober tinge in prospect when you wake into that fleeting final day. What's left to see and do could well be for the last time ever. Better shove aside regret at the unvisited and file the wondering recap for a future night, the row of shuttered photos evidence its bright eclipse of a more intimate gathering back of how you saw those ivory wings, rare threatened flower, odd little presences, quick skink, immobile moon snail, that uncapturable shade of lavender spreading in wet glaze up the tawny sand. Though not the taste of the impeccably sauced catch of the day, archive it together with white scent of oleander, natal plum, nectar of red honeysuckle, imprint from the friendly bay of islands, the sparkly royal blue undulations. Pretend the sun warming this moist salt air is cousin to what beams on your home lake. Under last night's clear stars, the sadness in eighth note flutings of the tree frogs was yours only. All yours here to make from what, if given casual, uncaring treatment, might simply be incongruous caprice and mere escape to excess luxury. This integral oasis, beyond easy trope of paradise one never can regain, convey its buoyancy deep in you, percolated down to your bedrock like a stubborn faith pooled for the betterment of all you care for anywhere. Soak its outlandish light into a forward vision loosed from time. I like to think that the benefit I had from this wonderful experience is something I can somehow share, convey to other people that I care about here that aren't so privileged.
Thank you for sharing that with us. So again, it's tomorrow night. There's an event at Supermarket at 6:30. Or is it at 6?
Yeah, that's the Quattro and Healis launch. Yeah, 6:30 is the start time.
And then the Main Street Library.
That's at 6
that's
o'clock.
That's at 6 o'clock. So yeah. People have a lot to do early in the evening, which is kind of nice to have it start. Alan, it was great to have you on. Thank you so much for coming on and sharing your poetry with us. And all the best with your new book coming out. It sounds like far away, but 2020 really isn't.
No, I suppose not.
Yeah. So all the best, and thanks again for coming in.
Thanks so much for having me.
You're very welcome. This is CIUT 89.5 FM, and I'd like to thank Chris Cavazzoso for teching tonight. Thank you so much, Chris. And we're going to listen to a track from Julian Taylor. This is a CD that I quite enjoy, and I misplaced it for a long time, and I have rediscovered it. So I'm so excited to share it with you. This is a Julian Taylor band, and this is Bobby Champagne on CIUT 89.5 FM. And we'll be right back with Degan Davis to talk to him about his book, What Kind of Man Are You?
She's got class and style, more than a moonlit night. And I know, yes I know, all I need to know. So here it goes. Well, I've been feeling you, I know you've been feeling me too. Could it be that it's me that you wanna see? So please, please tell me, what's your name? She said, I'm Bobby Champagne. Like a moth to the flame, I fell into the fire. Said, what's your name? She said, I'm Bobby Champagne. Like a moth to the flame, I fell into the fire.
I've been watching you, I see you've been watching me too. And I know how I feel, so let me ask you, what's the deal, baby? She's got midnight eyes, dark like a winter sky. And I know, yes I know, all I need to know. So here it goes. Well, what's your name? She said, I'm Bobby Champagne. Like a moth to the flame, I fell into the fire. Said, what's your name?
This is CIUT 89.5 FM, and we're in the process of just dealing with some stuff with the phone, and then we will be speaking with Degan Davis shortly, soon. And Alan Breezemaster has very kindly agreed to stay and keep me company and talk some more about publishing and about his work, and maybe read some more work for us tonight, and I appreciate Alan sticking around. This is CIUT 89.5 FM, and again, Chris Cavazoso, thank you so much for teching, and Valentino Asenza will be in the chair next week, and then we'll be back in 2 weeks on CIUT 89.5 FM. And I met Alan Breezemaster way back when I published my first book of full-length book of poetry called The Eel Ladder with Watershed Books. And Alan, you've been involved with lots of, I don't know what you would call that, a publishing cooperative or...
Yeah, well, that's what Watershed
that's what
Books
was. Yeah.
So over 3 years, we gave people the opportunity to fast track, in most cases, a first book. Some mm-hmm. others, was not their first book. But rather than wait that long interval first when you are just circulating your manuscript and hoping a publisher will latch onto it, and then when it is accepted, wait that much longer. And it was a vehicle for me to get my first full book of poetry out in fairly short order. It was a long time in coming, just building up the book, but the time was ripe, and it was a great experience for me. And that's also where I learned a lot about editing and book production.
Production.
The stages that you go through to create a book out of a pile of papers that may be in any wrong order, or the order that the author thinks is kind of cute, but it turns out they're a little bit too close to it to have the right perspective and see the further potential just of that, much less the individual poems needing a little bit of a trim sometimes, or a rewrite even. And we had team editing, which was very useful. In fact, it was truly was a co-op in all respects.
It was a really interesting experience. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, that was in the late 90s up to, 2001. And then everybody moved on and went on to other things.
And many have been very prolific in writing. And Lucy Brennan, who was part of that, I just saw her at the Art Bar a couple weeks ago.
Lucy is a wonderful writer.
She is.
Presenter of her work. She's a real bard.
She's a pleasure to watch.
Storyteller as well as a poet. She was one of our co-op and other people that are still active on the scene, some not so much. People's lives are unpredictable, including their literary lives, and I've seen a lot of people, you know, that were active when you and I were first sort of coming on the scene that have gone on to other things and are out of touch with. And some, of course, always new people emerging, which is exciting to discover. And I've really enjoyed, I've enjoyed very much both nurturing new and practically unknown novice writers who had a lot of talent, and moving them towards their first book, or at least their first publications. And as well, another kind of specialty of mine that's very dear to my heart is working with older writers whose lives kind of took over everything, and their talent was put on the back burner.
That's very common.
Some cases in their 60s and 70s or even 80s come out with their first book of poetry, and it is absolutely excellent. Mm. Maybe long overdue, but life takes its turns, and sometimes you go on a long detour. My record is a guy who was 92
His
first book, and lived long enough afterward to enjoy the very good reception that it got. Yeah.
Wow. That's awesome. So how does it work with Aeolus House if people wanted to submit? Do you accept unsolicited manuscripts?
I can't. People come to me who already know me, or they are referred to me by people who know what I do.
What you do.
And being a one-person operation, if I do 5 or 6 books a year, that's plenty, and I'm got a full load right now, and so I don't really advertise to the world at large. I just go along, and sooner or later somebody will come to me with an interesting proposal. I don't always say yes. I have to feel I'm excited by the work. Of course I can work with the author, and that the whole project concept is a good fit for my press and the kind of a scale of it. I've insisted with other people, go and send your manuscript out to a mainstream publisher. It's certainly good enough to be picked up by them. I feel that my own product is just as good as anything that the other press has put out, but that the authors typically are either they're in a hurry or they're somewhat on the margins. You know, they haven't been in the game. They don't have they haven't built up an audience that's going to buy their book. It's going to be for a smaller circle of friends, and they'll be happy with that. Which is not to say it couldn't be republished later by another press, or that an indefinite number of copies couldn't be printed if the demand justifies it. I guess that's what the situation is for me. And I'm sorry, people out there, but I am not open for business at this time anyway.
Well, it's good to know then, and then people will go to somewhere else. Anyway, Ellen, thank you so much. I really appreciate you hanging around, and all the best with tomorrow night and with your writings, and love to have you back again and talk some more.
Yes, thanks again, Nancy.
Oh, you're welcome.
I know I always enjoy being on the show here.
Well, it's great to have you here and to have you as a friend of Howl. It's very good. Thank you.
Thanks.
This is CIUT 89.5 FM. And again, thank you so much to Chris Cavazzoso for teching tonight. And I believe that we have Degan Davis on the phone.
Yes, hello.
Hi, Degan Davis. How are you?
I'm pretty good.
Oh, good. I'll just introduce you to our audience. Degan Davis spent his childhood in Mattawa, Ontario, at the confluence of two rivers. He works as a gestalt therapist, both in a university setting and in private practice. Degan's poetry and nonfiction have appeared in such places as the Globe and Mail, the Malahat Review, Riddle Fence, and the New Quarterly. He is currently working on a collection of essays about masculinity, femininity, and how to be a good man in this era. And he lived for many years in St. John's, Newfoundland, and now lives in Toronto. And
all true.
All good. and has published this book through Brick Books called What Kind of Man Are You? And congratulations on your book.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I just have to say, first off, too, I was listening to the interview with Alan, and this goes way back, but he... I think he still runs the Art Bar series. Is that right?
He was there till I think 2002.
And,
okay. Yeah, but very instrumental in making it very much what it is today.
Okay, and he was talking about mentoring different writers. But when I've been writing for a while, even though this is my first book, and I remember reading at that series and him being quite encouraging. This is in the 90s, so he may not even remember, but it was great to hear his voice. It's been a long time.
I'm sure he remembers, for sure, for sure. He speaks very highly of that time and all of his experiences with writers. Yes. So, yeah. What kind of man are you? That's quite a provocative title, I think.
Yeah, it's interesting in terms of how the title came about. My partner and I were looking through the manuscript as I was looking for a title, and I had this large piece of paper, and I was sitting on the floor, and she and I were reading out lines from the poems, and
okay.
You know, and if they seemed, you know, to have some resonance, I'd sort of put them closer to the center, and you know, if they were just an idea that I was playing with, they'd go to the outskirts. And then she just said, "What kind of man are you?" And I just wrote it right in the center, circled it, and said, "We're done here." And it felt, you know, just in that moment, it felt right. And after that, I sort of, it feels like it oscillates between, you know, that kind of societal taunt, like, you know, prove yourself. What kind of man are you? But then it also, I think, has that, or I hope it has that inquisitive sense too. Like, you know, what kind of man are you? You know, show me who you really are. You know.
For sure, and your book is set up in different sections. So that you cover off different areas. There, the first part I believe is speak, and then shoebox,
mm-hmm.
and where there is music, the blues and love songs.
Mm-hmm.
So you cover off a lot of different aspects and go back through history.
Yeah, I mean. When I was talking about, you know, reading at the Art Bar a while back, like I have been working on poetry for a while, and he mentioned, you know, some people writing poems and publishing them when they're much older. I'm 47 and I probably began in my 20s, and so I feel that way. I have some of these poems are actually, you know, from, I would say maybe five or six are from the 90s and 2000, and a lot of those are in that second section about my father. And so in a way that, you know, this book has had a long trajectory and kind of a long history. And I think the first and last sections really, I became really interested in this idea of, you know, what is it to be a man in this period, particularly in this period of gender fluidity. And those older poems about my father felt like they fit. They were slightly different, but they, you know, they were about fatherhood and about him and our relationship and that sort of thing. So that they seem to come into the theme and work.
Oh, for sure, it works It works all together. I like that part, postcard, and then with the year, and then have a subject matter for the poem. Would you like to read from your book for us?
Sure, yeah.
I just say, this is CIUT 89.5 FM, and I just want to mention that this is an all-inclusive language show, and there is expletive language throughout this book, and I'm just putting the disclaimer out there now, as I don't know which poem Degan will be reading.
Well, I thought, thank you for, yeah.
It's fine, like whatever.
Okay, got it. Let me just take a look. I think I'm going to start, not with that section, but I've written a couple of poems down that I was interested in sharing. I'm going to read the first poem called Tribe. And I did grow up, as you said, in a small town called Mattawa. Mm-hmm. And this was written for a friend, and I think there's this interest or yearning for people to seek ritual, for anyone to seek ritual. And this friend and I must have heard something around becoming blood brothers, and it might have been on television or on the radio or a story. But when I thought back to it before writing this, I felt like we were trying to kind of give shape to our friendship, give it something other. Anyhow, I'll read this this first poem called Tribe. Behind the five and dime, Peter, then I, slice veins with a Coke bottle shard, hold up our arms, a salute to forever, to federation, to love. Pulses cross-babbling heartward, our first move streetwise. Dark red streaming onto my blue rubbers. We are nine. Blood brothers, we say it out loud, itchy, edging closer. I watch myself, giddy, terrified, releasing the last breath of being self-contained in my own frantic circuit. Trust rehoused. Two tribes bled into one.
Thank you. You're listening to Degan Davis read from his debut poetry collection, which is published by Brick Books. So how did you come about publishing with Brick Books?
Well, I had sent the manuscript a couple of years ago in an earlier form, and I'd sort of come close in their process. You go through I have twin boys that are 5 months old.
Oh, wow.
And I just hear one, and I'm going to go upstairs and give one a little bit of milk as I tell you about this. Just 1 second.
This is CIUT 89.5 FM. We're speaking with Degan Davis, who has released his poetry collection called What Kind of Man Are You with Brick Books. And I believe he's back.
Yes, I'm back. the process at Brick is, it goes through three stages. So in a couple of years ago, I had the honor of getting close with this manuscript. And the last time, I think they felt it was ready. So I've had some communication, and I've had some, in a way, some mentorship throughout that process from Barry Dempster in particular.
Oh, great. Yeah.
And he was he edited this book, and that was a wonderful experience.
Yeah.
It's really something to see a poem and have that kind of communication back and forth, and really have the poem come into its own. So it felt like a real gift.
Oh, that's good. You had that experience to see it grow, how your work grew.
Absolutely.
Would you like to read one more?
Yes.
All right.
I was just thinking about what kind of man are you? I've got this twin that's just now calmed down. I will read one more. My apologies.
One more, and then we'll let you go be with your twins.
Okay, 1 second there.
This is CIUT 89.5 FM, and we're talking with Degan Davis, who is going to read us one more poem from his poetry collection called What Kind of Man Are You?
Hello.
Hi.
Okay. I'm sorry about that.
That's
I'm
okay.
Good now.
Okay, so one more poem, and then
yes, absolutely.
We'll let you go.
sure. I'm going to read one. Well, I really loved the music. Was it Bobby Champagne? Was that the name of the song?
Yeah, wasn't that a great song?
A great song.
Yeah.
Who's that by?
That's the Julian Taylor Band. They're a Toronto band.
Wonderful. I'm going to read one of my music poems. I've got a section on music.
Okay.
And this is this was a story I heard of Louis Armstrong and this how he invented scat.
Yeah. Okay.
And so I'll read
like this.
It's called Calling. And there's a little quote at the beginning. Some say in 1927, Louis Armstrong invented scat, an unsung singing by using his voice like an instrument. It started with some words. All the night before, he had hummed them to himself. In the bath, glancing over his shoulder to the soggy page. In the bedroom, the hook light warming his hands until his rhythm beat. At the studio, the rain fell down and got up. It was a day you had to face, straight. Courage is the shoulder of jazz. The words were about love. Louis was early. The musicians would be in soon, dragging their hangovers and their hard cases. I liked the quiet, he thought. Then out loud, it's a kingdom of its own, and I am humble before the king. He smiled and looked across at love on the page. The rain came up to the door, knocked and kept knocking. He took out his trumpet and answered with a call, finding his way through the fast falling, thinking, you have to construct one hell of a cakewalk to step with raindrops. The wind came then, flushing water up against the house, and suddenly the whole song changed. He attached the lyric sheet to the mic stand with a piece of packing tape from his case. They came in at 11, happy and smiling, loose from the rain and the outside, and soon the strings were humming in tune. Louis's eyes were open like the bells of horns, his cheeks bellows for a fire. 1927, June 3rd, take one. And he started it slow, the bassoon low beneath and the clarinet wailing up. He looked down to the lyric sheet, and there it was, soaking on the floor, one word left legible, you. Louis strained to see the word, started a growl, half instrument, half voice. Calling to the clarinet calling back, talking to someone it hadn't met yet. Louis, low, wordless, reaching for it, thought, I know a love song. I'm a Storyville boy. I know a love upstairs in the dark. We play and we bicker and zee-zee-la. She has a heart like a big brass crucifix. I'm flushed, bashful as the morning, with no sleep and just as alive. Away you are. Forever, each to all, no talking, no lyrics, no plans for the future, all the life and death in this hour, ZZ's on. He finished, picked up his horn for the ending, laughing through his bones. Mama, this is what I'm born to do.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate talking to you, Degan Davis, and all the best with your poetry collection.
Thank you so much, Nancy.
Take care.
Okay, bye.
Bye. That was Degan Davis we were speaking to, and we're going to be speaking momentarily with Joe Denham on CIUT 89.5 FM, and we're just going to listen to a track just shortly to another track from Julian Taylor just a little bit on CIUT, and then we'll be right back with Joe Denham.
Just keep your cool.
This is CIUT 89.5 FM, and I believe we have Joe Denham on the phone. Hey, Joe.
Hi, Nancy. How are you?
I'm good, thanks. How are you?
Good. Nice to hear your voice.
Yeah, it's good to talk to you again. And just to introduce you to our audience, if they're not familiar, Joe Denham is the author of four collections of poetry, including Regeneration Machine, Nightwood Editions 2015, which won the Canadian Authors Association Award for Poetry and was nominated for the 2016 Governor General's Award for Poetry. And Joe is also author of a novel, The Year of Broken Glass. His work has appeared in numerous magazines and anthologies, including Open Field, 30 Contemporary Canadian Poets, which was published by Persa 2005, as well as Spendthrift with Harbor 2017. And he lives with his family in Half Moon Bay in BC. So yes, it's great to have you back on Howl with this book called Landfall.
Yeah.
This is different, I guess, than they're all different, your books.
And yeah.
This is a bit more, I felt it was a bit more of a, parts of it were more of a, like a rant in a good way, if that makes
sense. Yeah, it's Landfall's the second in a series of books that started with Windstorm that was published in 2009.
Oh, okay. We didn't talk about that. No.
Yeah, that's okay. I'll give it to you real quick here. So what's happening essentially in Landfall is the Windstorm, the whole premise of the whole thing that I'm doing, they're sort of linked series of long poems.
Yes.
Basically. So there's not a lot of titling of poems. They're just pages that are sort of falling together. Windstorm, like I said, was published in 2009. I kind of started writing it 2004, 2005. So I've been working on this thing for a long time. Essentially, I'm a fish boat captain out in BC.
Yeah.
I kind of realized around 2004, 2005 that it was pretty likely, sort of based on the science of the thing and also based on what I was observing at that time as like a late 20s, early 30s captain in the industry, in terms of the human behaviors that were and how people thought and talked about what was going on with fish stocks and stuff like that, that I was pretty much likely to see the end of life in the ocean as we understand it by the time my lifetime was over. And that's a weird thing to digest, right?
It is.
Especially when you're making your living killing those things still, right? But at that point, I'd already been doing it for over a decade, and it's what I did. And I had a one-year-old and a newborn, and it was just like, okay, life was going along, and that's what was happening. And so I started writing the poems in Windstorm that sort of addressed that. And then when I finished Windstorm, I'd already started writing Landfall. Landfall, there's probably going to be three or four books, and there's sort of there's an arc to the whole thing, I think. But, you know, it's like it's happening as I'm living, so I can't really, don't know where it goes. But I can tell you that, like, in reference to your sort of comment on the rant thing, mm-hmm. Landfall's kind of the anger part of the thing.
Yeah, okay.
So Windstorm's kind of the sadness part of the thing.
The realization of...
Yeah, the, like, shock and sadness of, like, wow, that's really happening in my lifetime. That's a really... Right? And then that, of course, always flips over to sort of a anger or a bit of a rage as you accept that there's really not much you can really do about it, and I don't really feel that there is much that anyone can really do about it because it's a massive worldwide thing, and
it's a big
it's like everything. There's like how many billions of humans and how many more billions are going to be here, and there's just not enough of anything, and we're not stopping, right? So
it's true.
So Landfall, when I was writing Landfall, I had gotten to that point of like really feeling kind of angry about that but also accepting it in a weird kind of way. And so there's all that undercurrent of that in the writing, I think, you know. And I kind of, because I wanted to have that book as part of that, of the series of books that I'm writing in this, I kind of opened myself up to letting myself write that stuff, which I don't really usually do. Like, it's somewhat frowned upon to just hammer your reader over the head.
Yeah, Yeah, that's fair.
And I kind of do, I admittedly kind of do a bit of that landfall, but that's because really that's, I was trying to stay in the choices in terms of the writing and the editorial choices of what to leave in, what to take out, and how far to let that go.
Yeah, and
I decided to sort of honor, like, to stay honest to that emotion and that kind of, like, sense of things, right, as an expression.
So, for sure. No, yeah. It worked for me. It absolutely worked for me. So,
yeah,
so yeah, and I think, I mean, it does come from a place, I think, in your heart, and that shines through. So, yeah, hammer me over the head. I'm fine with that.
yeah. And the other thing that like, as much as it's coming from that place where it's a continuation of that thread of being a fisher and dealing with that likely loss, and whether we actually see the end of life in the oceans in our lifetime or whether we just see a massive dwindling that we're living in the midst of right now, you know, whatever, either way, it's hard to live inside of, you know, and if it's not me in the oceans, it's someone in any walk of life is living through this thing that we're going through right now on Earth, right? So,
and it's going faster, I think, than anyone really predicted.
Well, it's an exponential thing, right? It's an exponential thing. Like, there's most estimates 10 years ago were that we were down to 10% of pre-industrial fishing stocks worldwide, right?
Fishing stocks.
I shouldn't say fishing. That was 10 years ago.
So it must be.
And we still continue to take, what is it, 100 million tons of fish per year out of the ocean worldwide. And so it's just like, you know, and when you're already at the brink and you just keep pounding away at it, eventually it's going to give, right? And I, you know, for me personally, the fishery that I work in, when I started working in it, I was a captain at the age of 22. Was my first year running a boat. I'm 42 now, so it's been 20 years. Running fishing boats. And when we started, my first season was an 8-month season with unrestricted trap haul sort of quota kind of thing.
Yeah.
And now we get 300 traps a day, and we get 30 days.
Joe, we'll have to continue this another time. It's great to talk to you, and we just barely scratched the surface. So we'll have you back on HOWL and to continue this conversation, if that's okay with you.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay, yeah. Good. Because our time's out.
I heard you. I heard you saying in the background when I was talking to the other person that time was tight.
Yeah.
so that's fine. So I won't take up any more of your time. Thank
you.
Don't
get me. I mean, I wish I could. Trust me.
Yeah, it's fine.
Okay. We'll do this again.
It's all good, Nancy.
Okay.
Yeah, nice to talk to you again.
Okay. Good to talk to you too. This is Nancy Jane Bullis Greer talking with Joe Denham. We'll have him back on the show. Alan Breezemaster, thank you so much for coming in tonight and talking about Aeolus House and the two events. And thank you also to Degan Davis with his book, What Kind of Man Are You? Please stick around for Great Canadian Radio at 11 o'clock, Sac City. And this is Nancy Jane Bullis signing off. Please remember, lights on bikes. Cheers.